What has happened, everybody? James Hancock here. We recently got the good news that Denis Villeneuve is getting the band back together to make Dune Part 2, tackling the events from the second half of Frank Herbert's classic novel. And of course, it'd be great if they were to keep going with books like Dune Messiah, which Villeneuve has expressed an interest in doing, and there are loads of fanatics out there who will not rest until we get to see all the crazy shit in books like Children of Dune and God Emperor of Dune. But for now, in the short term, I thought it'd be fun to cook up a video discussing all the really interesting stuff we can look forward to seeing in the next movie, one that we know for certain we'll be getting in October of 2023. I'm not going to do a complete summary of the plot, but rather focusing on key scenes, ideas, and characters that I love dearly. And because I love doing top 10 lists, I might as well organize this video in that format. So to be clear, from here on out, everything I'll be discussing could potentially be a massive spoiler for anyone not planning on reading the first novel if they've not already done so. The book's been out since 1965, so none of these details are a big secret, but I have to offer this warning or some folks out there will prick me with a gum jabbar. My advice for everyone who loved the recent movie would be to go check out the source material and then read it all over again and prepare to get completely absorbed and immersed in a singular reading experience. So if you're still with me at this point, everything is fair game from here on out. So let's just dive right in with my number 10 with a scene that should have already happened in terms of where it falls in the novel, but I'm hoping that Denis Villeneuve will work it into the next movie somehow. If you saw my spoiler review for the movie, you'll know that my favorite scene in the entire film was when Paul's prescience gives him a glimpse of a possible future or outcome, where we see Paul victorious in battle, eventually returning with his army of fanatics to Caladan as a conqueror, effectively the leader of a galaxy-wide jihad. But in the book, Paul sees two possible outcomes, the first of which has always floored me, and here's how it went originally. He had seen two main branchings along the way ahead, and when he confronted an evil old baron and said, "Hello, grandfather," the thought of that path and what lay along it sickened him. I mean, that is just beautiful writing. And as many of you out there know, I'm obsessed with well-written villains, the Baron being one of the best ever. And I find this tiny little scene just bone-chilling. Because Paul, he's already so dangerous and has so many abilities. Just imagine how much more dangerous he would be under the tutelage of his maternal grandfather. And if you're wondering how Jessica turned out to be the Baron's daughter, you can thank the Bene Gesserit and their endless manipulation of bloodlines. Number 9, this is a scene that could have easily been the end of the first movie, but my hope is that it'll end up being the first scene in the next movie. But after Paul's duel with Jameis, there's a great scene where Paul has to take on new names in order to become part of Stilgar's Siege. And he needs one name to be used in secret, and he needs another name that Stilgar and the rest of the Siege can use openly. But the dialogue is just marvelous, and it's the beginning of this incredible friendship between Paul and Stilgar. Stilgar says, "I see strength in you, like the strength beneath a pillar. You shall be known among us as Usul, the base of the pillar." That scene of the original David Lynch film is just absolutely fantastic. But when it comes time for Paul to select his name that'll be used openly, he remembers the little desert mouse that we saw in the first film. And Stilgar tells him that the creature is called Muad'Dib, a name which confirms yet another one of Paul's visions of the future and is further proof of his evolving abilities. And Paul's friendship with Stilgar, for me, is one of the most enjoyable aspects of the second half of the novel. My favorite bit being when Paul refuses to fight Stilgar in a duel for leadership, something that all the young Fremen are urging him to do. But whatever happens in the next movie, all I can say is that we need a lot more Javier Bardem in part 2. But while we're on the subject, for my number 8, we might as well get into the idea of Paul's prescience. The simplest way to describe prescience is the ability to see in the past, present, and future. And toward the end of the book, Paul's ability on this front reaches its full potential after Paul nearly dies from drinking the water of life. Now, the water of life, that's a liquid that's created by drowning a sandworm in water. And that liquid is typically used to turn Bene Gesserit sisters into reverend mothers. But more on that later and how it relates to the Lady Jessica. Anyone who doesn't have the skills of the Bene Gesserit who drinks the water of life is doomed to die in absolute agony. But Paul, being who he is, instead becomes the Kwisatz Haderach, the one who can be many places at once. Now, the Bene Gesserit had hoped to have this being under their firm control, but their hopes were in vain. As he later tells the Reverend Mother Gaius Helen Mohiam,
"Try looking into that place where you dare not look. You will find me there staring back at you."
"You mustn't speak!"
And that exchange was absolutely brilliant in the David Lynch film. But the first demonstration in the book of Paul's new abilities is when he tells Chani and Jessica that this giant armada is up in space above Arrakis and is about to invade, leading us into the killer conclusion of the novel. But this power comes with a terrible burden, where Paul fully understands how nearly all of his actions and decisions are leading toward this horrible jihad that'll claim countless lives, no matter how badly he might want to try and avoid this eventuality. All I can say is, it ain't easy being a messiah figure. Moving on to number 7, I'm looking forward to seeing Paul riding a worm for the first time. Now, there are many steps in Paul's journey towards becoming this messianic figure for the Fremen, and David Lynch, he just crushed this scene, so I can't wait to see what Denis Villeneuve does with it, because this is one of those big, giant, just epic, larger-than-life moments that any filmmaker is going to have a lot of fun with. But number 6, Princess Irulan, or Irulan, depending upon how you like to pronounce it, but she's the daughter of the Padishah Emperor and played by the beautiful Virginia Madsen in the 1984 adaptation. And while she isn't necessarily a key part of the action of the book until the very end when she enters his arranged marriage with Paul, nonetheless, her presence is felt keenly throughout the book with her many brilliant passages and insights from her manual of Muad'Dib. And I'm not quite sure how Denis Villeneuve would incorporate these details visually, but I find them fascinating to read, and I hope that Denis Villeneuve will tip his hat to them in some way. The real question is, how is Denis Villeneuve going to wrap up the movie? Because the book famously has this kind of clumsy, awkward exchange between Jessica and Chani about how history is going to look back upon them as wives. And I don't really have a big problem with these last few lines, but an epic movie is going to need something with a lot more punch. I don't know, perhaps a scene where we see this fleet of fanatical Fremen soaring out into space to kill in the name of Muad'Dib. We'll have to wait and see. But let's get into my number 5 with a character who I seriously doubt will make the final cut. However, I have to mention Count Fenring. A mysterious figure who's a mentat, he's an assassin, and he's one of the chief advisors to the Padishah Emperor. And what makes him so interesting is how he came very close to being the Kwisatz Haderach long before Paul, but the genetics didn't quite work out. He's a eunuch, but in spite of his handicap, he has other unique abilities like being completely invisible to Paul's heightened senses. And his presence at the finale gives Paul some of his only serious doubts, because in all of his visions of the future, none of these outcomes included Count Fenring. And that final scene is so rich, with so many great confrontations, and of course the duel with Fade Rautha. But Count Fenring, he's the Emperor's final weapon at his disposal. And what's fascinating is how Fenring suspects. He knows that he actually could kill Paul then and there, but he refuses. And then for the first and only time in the entire novel, we see Paul look upon someone else as a kindred spirit. Someone he can actually relate to. So fingers crossed, Denis Villeneuve decides this character should make the final cut of part 2. And for my number 4, I've got Paul's reunion with Gurney Halleck. In the latter part of the novel, there's this battle between Paul's Fremen and a group of spice smugglers, a group that Gurney's kind of been hiding out with ever since the Harkonnen attack. Now, both in the book and in David Lynch's 1984 adaptation, I've always found this scene to be the most emotionally moving scene in the entire story. Patrick Stewart really sells the realization that the young Duke is in fact alive. But what I really like about the scene in the book is the way we see it initially from Gurney's perspective as he meets Paul in battle. He doesn't immediately recognize him, but he recognizes that from Paul's crouch and readiness, he's clearly a trained fighting man. The irony is that Gurney's admiring his own handiwork because he taught Paul these skills. At any rate, this is always the part of the story where I feel like crying when these two amazing characters are finally reunited in their common cause against the Harkonnens. Number 3, Mentats. As I mentioned in my earlier reviews, I was a little frustrated by how in the first movie, the Mentats Thufir Hawat and Peiter de Vries both kind of got the shaft. Never at any point was there any info that would help the uninitiated even understand the function of a Mentat or how they came to be. And my hope is that Thufir Hawat and his training of Paul will be explored more deeply in the second movie. Paul's Mentat training is a key building block in his prescience, and furthermore, the reunion between the two of them when Thufir dies in Paul's arms near the finale after refusing to betray the Atreides family, this scene won't have the proper impact unless the second movie manages to dig a little deeper into their relationship. Which leads me right into my number 2, Fade Rautha, who in the novel slowly gets manipulated by Thufir Hawat into attempting to kill Baron Vladimir Harkonnen after the Harkonnens force Thufir into their service. And Fade Rautha, he's basically Paul's opposite number or counterpart in the Harkonnens, but he starts getting a little overly ambitious for power, which opens the door to Thufir convincing him to try and kill the Baron. And what's funny is how when he fails, the Baron's almost kind of strangely proud of Fade's ambition. So he brings him under his wing and he tells him all about his master plan, which basically involves the beast Draban being so brutal and so oppressive on Arrakis that when the Baron finally sends Fade to replace him, he'll be embraced. And as great as Fade's final duel with Paul might be, I hope we're going to see some of Fade's time in the gladiator arena, where we see him cheating with all these poisons and secret command words to stack the odds in his favor. Count Fenring's wife, the Lady Fenring, she's so impressed, she wants to get Fade's seed right in her belly. But all that aside, whoever gets cast as Fade, they're going to be getting the opportunity of a lifetime. He's a fantastic villain, and one of my favorite ingredients in the overall saga. And finally, my number 1, Saint Alia of the Knife. Now, I've seen some people pronounce her Alia, and other people pronounce her Alia. But either way, Alia Atreides is Paul's little sister who, like Paul, has to carry this horrible burden of being regarded as a freak or an abomination by many. What makes her unique is how the Lady Jessica unwittingly affects Alia in her womb when she drinks the water of life. Only Jessica's love prevents the unborn child from going completely insane as she gains all the memories and knowledge of previous Reverend Mothers. And by age two, she's walking around and talking like an adult, which makes the Fremen very uneasy. And then after she's captured toward the end of the novel, the Reverend Mother guides Helen Mohiam, she urges the Emperor and Baron Harkonnen to kill Alia then and there. But like a total gangster, Alia Atreides kills her grandfather with her Gamjabar and then rushes out into this pitched battle to help kill off wounded Harkonnen and Sardaukar fighters. And as she does so, she marks them so their water can be collected, hence her nickname, Alia of the Knife, easily one of the freakiest characters in the Dune saga, whose character arc gets increasingly disturbing as the story progresses beyond the first book, but that is another discussion for another day. So looking ahead, the good news is that I have 2 full years to finish Frank Herbert's saga. I've never read books 5 and 6, and I'm increasingly getting the itch to do so. But let me know in the comments below what you're looking forward to seeing in the next movie. I'm just relieved that we're getting the movie at all. Every once in a while, Hollywood makes the right decision, and I wish everyone involved with the project the best of luck. But I hope everyone enjoyed this video. If so, remember to like the video, subscribe to the channel, hit that notification bell, yada, yada, yada. Hope everyone has an amazing weekend, but more importantly, as always, onwards and upwards.